with his guest stars, David Niven. Cast Daley. Janis Paige. Les Brown and his band of renown. Brought to you by amazing new Minute Rice for perfect rice without cooking. And wonderful new Jell-O Instant Puddings, America's busy day dessert. And now, the Bob Hope Show.
St. Patrick's number, and I want to welcome you to our Jell-O show. You know, tomorrow is St. Patrick's Day. Faith and begotta, top of the morning. Saints preserve us, and a happy Pat O'Brien to you all. Yes, sir, in honor of St. Patrick's Day, my sponsor's coming out with a special package of lime Jell-O. It's shaped like Morton Downey. I hope you like it. But you can say what you want about the Irish if you have enough insurance. And I want to tell you right now, there are nothing but Irish tunes on the radio, and it's all very democratic. I heard one announcer say today, and now Pat O'Reilly and his four shamrocks play Irish Eyes. But first, a word from our sponsor, Manischewitz Wine. You know, the last time Marilyn Monroe was in Ireland, she kissed the Blarney Stone. It's the first time the Blarney Stone ever kissed back. It was quite a And of course, this St. Patrick's Day down in Washington, they tell me Secretary of the Army Stevens is singing, "Ireland Must Be Heaven Because McCarthy Isn't There." President Eisenhower takes the bass part, but you know, these days, you can't. Really, you can't open a newspaper without reading about McCarthy. Yesterday, there was a headline that said, "McCarthy Ties Shoelaces. Army claims he tied left one first." That's what it said in the paper. I'm glad I didn't. But I want to tell you one thing. No, honestly, I don't think Secretary Stevens harbors any grudge against Senator McCarthy. It's just a coincidence that the draft law has been changed to include all married senators of 45 who come from Wisconsin. Now, I think it's just a coincidence. I really do. And too bad, it's too bad that we don't have color TV, ladies and gentlemen, so you folks out there could see this opening St. Patrick's number with all that color. I haven't seen that much green since Jack Benny came out of his vault to pay for the wedding. I don't know how much the wedding cost, but it's the first time the bride's father ever cried louder than the mother. I was there, I want to tell you. I was the tallest flower girl there, and I loved it. And I've never seen such a spectacle. What a wedding that was. That's what the coronation would have been like if England had Benny's money. $50,000 it cost. And Benny really paid for it. I know. I spoke to the doctor who gave him a physical just before they handed the check. But really, it was a beautiful wedding with all the people throwing old shoes and Jack trying them on. I tell you what. And We want to wish Joan and her husband a lot of luck. Isn't that wonderful? A trip to Honolulu and a $50,000 wedding. Of course, Jack wanted them to spend their honeymoon somewhere else, but they'd already been to Knott's Berry Farm, so they... And the champagne, I want to tell you, the champagne at the party flowed just like you'd expect champagne to flow with Benny paying for it. Of course, but Mary came in and made him take the nipples off the bottles and everything. You know why Jack served champagne, don't you? He found out it was slightly cheaper than coffee. How about those coffee prices? Just this afternoon, a fellow at Hollywood and Vine asked me for a nickel for a cup of coffee. So I gave it to him and followed him. Anyway, I just want to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, that Jack Benny made sure that he invited everyone to the wedding that had been nominated for an Academy Award. He figured they couldn't eat much with their fingers crossed, you know what I mean? Because the Academy Award is a show that's going to be on TV next week, and of course you'll see the winners on TV this year. It'll be a little complicated because the losers are demanding equal time. I understand that I'm very close to two Oscars this year. I'm sitting between Levant and Hammerstein. And I think it's funny that Frank Sinatra should get a nomination as Best Supporting Actor all these years. He's the one that's needed the support. And I think it's just, but we hope you enjoy our show tonight. We really do. We have a nice cast here. We have Janis Paige and her all-girl figure. She's back with us. This is sort of a repeat performance, a second appearance with me. She's very talented and very brave. And Janis, of course, will soon be opening in a new musical show on Broadway. She has a very important part in the pajama game. I don't know if it's the top or the bottoms, but it's a very important part. And, of course, we're very lucky to get David Niven tonight on the show. You all saw David in the Academy Award nomination for the Best Picture of the Year, The Moon is Blue, originally titled Space Cadet and His Leaky Fountain Pen. And also, we have Cass Daley with us, a triumphant return engagement. After her last appearance with us, some people wrote in and said, isn't she a little crazy? I'm here to tell you that Cass is perfectly all right. She has all her marbles. Just that she carries them around in her pocket. And Les Brown and his wonderful band and renown, of course, he's with us. He's still there. The boys are a little tired this evening. The bass fiddle needed restringing, and Les has had them out running down cats all day, so they're a little beat. Aren't they, huh? So is that joke. But anyway, I want to tell you, coming up now is a fine, fine product called Minute Rice, and I want you to try it. At our house, we think it's the lightest, fluffiest rice we ever ate. And Dolores says that with Minute Rice, you really do get perfect rice without cooking. You're going to see how true that is right now. As you probably know, the Saturday Evening Post is currently printing my biography called This Is On Me, just as I told it to Pete Martin. There it is. One of the most nostalgic chapters in the story is how I broke into vaudeville. It happened way back in 19... But it was quite a while ago, and my girlfriend, Mildred Rosequist, and I would rehearse an act and then try it out. Of course, her mother was against it, but we managed to play a few dates around Cleveland, And then we got our first out-of-town booking, a one-night stand at a town called Ottawa, Ohio. Now with Janis Paige playing Mildred Rosequist, let's go back to that day when we got off the train at Ottawa. Come on, Mildred. Let's go to the theater. Come on, honey.
Bob, listen. Yeah. Listen, I hope the act works, because you know how my mother feels about me going in vaudeville, especially with you.
Oh, honey, don't worry about your mother. When we get rich and famous, we let her wash our money for us once in a while. Come on, let's go.
All right.
Oh, howdy, friend. We're strangers in town.
Welcome to Ottawa.
Yeah.
You show folks?
Yeah, where's the Bijou Theater?
Right down the street, one block across the street from the firehouse.
Oh, really? Come on, honey, let's go down there. Wait a minute. Let's run through the act once before
that's
we
a
go.
Good idea.
Now, don't forget, I'm standing in the center stage.
I'm not here.
You're off in the wings, and I say, how do you do, ladies and gentlemen? A funny thing happened on the way to the theater. A fella asked me for a bite, so I bit him. Oh, pardon me, miss, your motor is running. Tell me, what do you got in the bag?
Mustard.
Mustard?
Yeah, you can never tell when you're going to meet a ham.
Say, you're a girl, aren't you?
Yeah, how can you tell?
Well, you're built more like my mother than my father. How about that? Honey.
Yeah, I think that's very good,
then,
huh?
Then wait for the laugh right there, see?
How do you know there's going to be a laugh on that line?
Baby, there'll be two laughs there.
Two?
Yeah, once when my pants fall down, and the second one when the audience sees my polka dot shorts. That's a bomb.
See? Oh, yeah, I know what you mean.
See?
Yeah, okay.
Are you ready?
Yeah, I'm
all right.
Ready.
Then I say, tell me. How do the flowers, do you know how the flowers grow?
Sure, they got roots in the ground.
Yeah, that's funny. Then I say, cows grow a lot bigger, and their roots don't even touch the ground.
Oh, boy, that's keen.
That's our big smash, you see? We got them right there.
Yeah.
Boy, this'll kill them.
Yeah.
You better. It'll either be them or you.
Careful, Ezra, I'll grab your suspenders and snap you to death. Watch yourself, you see? Honey, wait for that laugh, you know?
Yeah,
you know
yeah.
Where my nose is supposed to light up? Not there, you see, when I'm whistling and waving the flag, you know, like that?
Oh, yeah, I remember.
Then I lean down and I say to the leader, if you please, Professor. Then I say, honey, take in my arms, and I say, it was heaven the first night I met you.
I feel the same way, Bob.
You are my lucky star.
I saw you from afar.
Two lovely eyes at me, they were gleaming.
Beaming. I was starstruck.
Oh, you lucky star. Look at me once in a while.
Hey, Bob.
Yeah.
You know what?
What?
I went to the doctor this morning, and he said I had to go to the mountains for my kidneys.
The doctor said you had to go to the mountains for your kidneys?
Yeah, I didn't even know they were up there.
Are you? Hey, we got it. Let's go, baby. Come on.
So Mildred and I opened our act at the Bijou. And I have to be honest, it was anything but a smash. Toward the end, it got pretty grim. In fact, we sang our last song from a crouching position so we could get to the exit in a hurry.
Boy, what an audience. We gotta get a net.
Look at all these tomato stains on my mother's dress. Yeah. Imagine them throwing tomatoes.
The least they could have done was take them out of the cans.
Bob, what went wrong with the act?
Everything, honey, everything. Look, when I said my middle name is Lifesaver, you were supposed to say, is that because you have a hole in your head? Not, I think Lifesaver's a pretty name. Where'd you get that line?
Well, I can't help it. I did everything else right. When you said, where do bugs go in the wintertime? I said, search me. Why didn't that get a laugh?
Oh, I don't know. It's on account of that act down ahead of us. That crummy act doing all our jokes. That blonde, that dumb blonde, and that guy with the cigar. What was the name of that act?
Burns and Allen.
Why don't people like that give up and buy a chicken ranch? Where are they going anyway? Don't worry, honey. When we get to Sandusky, we'll fix up this vehicle, and I tell
you... Oh, there you are.
Mother!
Lunt and Fontaine. Oh, I finally caught up with you.
Mrs. Rosequist, what are you doing here?
I followed you down here on the bus. And I was in the audience this evening.
Oh, how'd you like the act, Ma? You know, it's a little rough, but you got to admit it's got something.
Yeah. And it'll take them a month to get it out of the curtains. Mildred, get your suitcase. You're going home with me.
Now, just a minute.
I've got two words for you. Drop dead.
You told me that back in Cleveland.
Yeah, I know, but you haven't done it yet. I didn't raise my girl to go on the stage with you. You over-smoked ham.
Now, just a minute. Hold it. I got plenty of talent. All I need is a little funny material.
You'll never improve on what Mother Nature gave you.
Thank you, 100 proof.
100 proof?
Yeah, old crow. I can't help it.
Oh, that did it. Come, Mildred.
Now, wait a minute. Mrs. Rosequist. Mrs. Rosequist, I just want to say a couple of words. I hope you realize that you're the dark cloud that's hiding two rising young stars, two people that are destined to climb the ladder of success to the pinnacle of fame and fortune. Don't you think?
Ah, shut up!
Nerve of that woman. Should have known she'd be around. Bats always come out after dark. Telling me I got no talent. The last show I did, my dressing room was filled with flowers. Cost me $50, but it was worth it. Well, my girl's gone, my act's gone. What am I gonna do now? Hey, maybe I better call Joe, the guy with the dancing bear in his act. I heard the bear was sick. All I'd have to do is let my hair and nails grow. Oh, well, toujours l'amour. C'est la guerre. No talent. Who else in Cleveland can speak Spanish? Well, that train for Sandusky ought to be here any minute now. Oh, honey! Honey, you got back! What happened, baby?
Oh, I talked Mom into letting us try it again in Sandusky.
Oh, isn't that wonderful?
Yeah.
Honey, we'll go up there. This is our type of audience. I tell you, we'll kill them, honey. We're on our way. Do you believe me?
Yeah,
isn't
sure.
That great? Forgot to flag it.
What about our date in Sandusky? Hey, when's the next train?
Next week, same time.
What are we going to do now?
I don't know, honey. I better...
Howdy, folks. You still here?
Oh,
what's going on?
We just missed our train to Sandusky.
Yeah, we open there tomorrow.
Well, if you don't mind riding with the top down, you can use this.
You're kidding?
Yeah.
Oh, that's boy.
Thank you.
The new Nash. How about that? Honey.
Yeah.
Honey, these things pump very easy, so you pump the first 10 miles and I'll steer, huh?
All right.
All right. And don't forget, when we get to Sandusky, I've got a great new gag where I put in the show.
Oh, wonderful.
And where I say, Ireland's the richest country in the world.
Well, why is Ireland the richest country in the world?
Because its capital is Dublin.
That's key.
Hey, we'll kill him, boy. No, baby. Okay.
You are
my lucky. I can't stand it.
this time, ladies and gentlemen, the makers of No Fat, the diatonic salami that leaves your breath kissing sweet, are proud to present Postcards to Priscilla. And here is the star of our show, Priscilla Plump.
I want to thank all you lovely people for taking the time to write me. You have no idea how much your sad, miserable postcards are doing to me. They're making me rich. Please keep on writing me about your miserable lives. Tonight's miserable postcard comes from a miserable little man who signs himself Miserable. Dear Priscilla, have you ever thought about what goes through a man's mind on his first visit to a psychiatrist's office? As he sits wondering what sort of monster he is about to meet, he can't help feeling that he has made a mistake coming here at all. There's nothing wrong with him. He's no different than anyone else. Or is he? And then the big problem. Does he dare tell the psychiatrist what is really on his mind?
Haven't been waiting long, but the doctor was called out on an emergency. What is your name, please?
Priscilla Plump. I mean, David Nosegay. Oh, nurse, will the doctor be here soon? This is my first visit to a psychiatrist's office, and I'm rather edgy.
Oh, he'll be here any minute now. Would you care to wait in his office?
Thank you.
Sorry about the delay, but the doctor had to mix up in appointments. May I take your things?
Oh, thank you.
Make yourself comfortable.
Thank
you. All right, let's have a little brain service here. Where's the head shrinker? Fine way to run a psychiatrist's office. Doesn't even have a nurse. I bet she's in there necking with him. I had a nurse, that's what I'd be doing.
Oh, you crazy mixed up gourd. Oh, my skull.
Oh, there you are. What time you got here?
Oh, am I late?
Well, it doesn't matter. Let's get started.
You read any good books lately?
Psychiatry is rather uncomfortable, isn't it?
Yeah. Maybe it isn't for skinnier people. Where do we start?
Well, first of all, I think that $50 an hour is outrageous.
So do I.
I think 20 is more than enough.
Would you think 10 would be more than enough?
Yes, I would.
Let's settle for 5.
Oh, good show. Boy, I thought the psychiatry was too expensive.
You know what this country needs is a cut-rate psychiatrist who goes from door to door with a hammock on a pushcart.
Look, I don't want to be old-fashioned, but aren't you supposed to be up there in the driver's seat?
No, you are.
Oh. Are you sure? In England, it's the other way around.
Yeah, but you drive on the wrong side of the street there, too.
A bit peculiar, but I'll take a crack at it.
Well, Wizard, let's get started, huh?
Well, first, I'll give you the details of my early childhood.
I can't think of a more nauseating proposition. Look, you have this backwards. I talk, you listen.
You quite sure?
Quite.
Well, you give me the details of your early childhood.
How early?
Well, you can start with your birth. There's not much point in going back any further than that.
My childhood. Oh, how different life would have been if only I'd been born a woman. Or a man. Or even a boy. But I was just a baby. Living in an incubator. Dad couldn't afford a crib, so he tossed me in with the chickens. For a long while, I thought I was one of the hens. It took the rooster a whole year to talk me out of laying an egg at the crack of dawn. I shouldn't have stopped. Look at the price of eggs today. I could have made millions. Pay attention, these are the neuroses.
By a strange coincidence, I had a similar unhappy experience in my early childhood. It all started in the little hospital where I was born. In the next crib was a lovely little baby girl, a girl who was to change the whole course of my life. One day, she looked through the bars of the crib and winked at me, and I tipped my didi. Then she opened her mouth to say something, and it happened. She blew a bubble. I blew a bubble back, and...
And then you challenged her to a drool?
And I realized that she was intellectual, and I wanted to give her my fraternity pin, but I had no fraternity pin, so I gave her the only pin I was wearing, and after that, I had to remain undercover.
I don't know whether this boy studied under Sigmund Freud or Pinky Lee. Tell me, did you ever see her again?
Oh, many times, but I never dared tell her, never dared tell her of my love.
Why not?
Oh, the vagaries of chance, the cruelties of fate, an error made by a careless intern, and poof, my dreams turned to ashes.
What do you mean?
That little girl grew up to be Rocky Marciano.
You know, if I had known your life had such big jokes in it, it would have been my life. Well, that's all I have to say. Shall we settle up?
Yes, it's $5, isn't it?
All right.
Oh, tell me, is it customary in America for the doctor to pay the patient?
No, but I'm willing to play by the English rules.
Just a minute. Aren't you the doctor?
No, aren't you?
No.
Well, who is?
Sorry, I'm late, gentlemen. Had an emergency. Oh, I'm Dr. Wedge. Would you pull up a couch and lie down?
Oh, but Doc, there's two of us.
Oh, I hadn't noticed. Well, no problems. Oh, nurse! Turn in the equipment. I'm going to analyze them both at once.
You'll probably be president someday. How do you like that? A double header.
Just a minute, chum. Upstairs. I paid for the lower. I'll send the oxygen up later.
Wake me when we get to Buffalo.
All right, then we'll start with you. What seems to be your problem?
Oh, Doctor, I have a grave problem. Every time I see a woman, the same thing happens.
Oh, well, tell me about it.
Well, last Saturday was a pretty typical example. I went round to the apartment of a young lady I've known for some time.
To hear your voice. Oh, you don't know what you do to me. Take me in your arms and kiss me, kiss me, kiss me!
Oh, stop nagging.
How can you treat me like this? You know I'm starved for your affection. My lips are burning with desire. You haven't kissed me since Friday.
That'll have to hold you over the weekend.
I know I'm not much to look at, nothing to see, but why can't I have a man crazy for me? Well, say something.
Will it be a hit or a miss? My dear, you seem a little overwrought. I think I'll take a walk around the block until your blood settles down to a slow boil.
Oh! If you go out that door, I'll jump!
You're bluffing. Fool me.
All right, sir, what about your problem?
Oh, well... The girl I go with is madly in love with me. There's no other man in the world for her.
Well, what's your problem?
Well, I'm insanely jealous. For no reason at all, I'm suspicious of her. Like last night, I went to visit her. All right, baby, let your hair down. Lover Lips is here to make it curl.
It's you.
Oh, well, honey, don't get too excited. There's enough for me to go around. Man, 3 weeks in San Francisco. 3 long weeks.
When are you going?
Going? I just got back. Did you miss me, honey? What'd you do while I was away?
Oh, I just sat here night after night knitting.
Must have used some awfully tricky needles. Honey, you must be lonesome when I go away like that. You ought to find yourself a hobby. She found it. What are these?
The doctor must have left those.
Oh, really?
Uh-huh.
And how about this?
Well, he was a pharmacist's mate. That's the That's the only medical man I could find in the middle of the night.
Yeah, and what about this here?
Well, you see, he drives a cab when his ship is in dry dock. Oh, I tell you, I had a terrible fever. I was just absolutely burning up.
Yeah, well, how about this here?
Well?
I know, he put out the fire.
Well, gentlemen, I think I have a solution to your problem. Your girlfriends are obviously not suitable. One is too demonstrative, and the other is not demonstrative enough. Therefore, I suggest that you exchange girlfriends.
Well, that's a great idea.
Good.
Here's a photograph of my girlfriend. Well, just a minute. This is my girl.
But this is my girl.
You think you guys got trouble? That's my wife.
Strolling with my Louie, where the dew is super dewy in the morning. Butterflies all flutter up and kiss each little buttercup at dawning. If I had Aladdin's lamp for only a day, you know what? I'd make a wish, and here's what I'd say, quote, nothing could be finer than to be Carolina in the morning.
A good start for a Lenten meal, tuna and rice. How about a minute rice and tuna treat for tomorrow night's supper? You can make it in a whiz when you make it with revolutionary new minute rice. You know, minute rice makes perfect rice without cooking. Let me show you. You add minute rice and salt to boiling water. Stir to moisten. There's no washing, no rinsing, draining, or steaming. Just cover and let it set while you go on with the tuna part of our dish. First, saute in 2 tablespoons of butter, 2.5 tablespoons each of diced green pepper and pimento, and 2 tablespoons of diced onion. Cook until tender, but not brown. Then mix in 1 can of condensed cream of celery soup, 1/2 cup of water. Then carefully stir in 1 can of tuna fish, drained and flaked. After heating thoroughly, stir in 1 tablespoon of lemon juice and 2 hard-cooked eggs cut into 6. Then all you do is spoon the tuna mixture over the minute rice add a little garnish, and there it is. Minute rice and a tuna treat. The perfect Lenten dish for your hungry husband and family. You'll love the way minute rice absorbs the savory flavor of that tuna mixture. Get this thrifty family-sized package at your grocer's. You get perfect rice without cooking when you use minute rice.
In her previous appearance on the Bob Hope Show, Cass Daley portrayed a girl who came to Hollywood to get into pictures and wound up as a waitress at a film studio commissary. Tonight, Miss Daley gives us chapter two in the life of that fascinating, irrepressible character, Marion Monroe.
Miss Monroe! Miss Monroe, come here at once. Oh. I've just had word that the most important director on the Empire lot is on his way over here for lunch. I refer, of course, to Orson Von Hope.
Oh, gee. And I'm trying to get in pictures. You know he's liable to walk in here, take one look at me, and make me a star. Oh, boy, I better look my best, huh? Fairy tales can come true. Ah, there. How's that? Is my makeup smeared?
On that face, how does one tell?
Yeah, I know. When I was born, the doctor slapped the wrong end. Oh, well, I better freshen up anyway. You can never tell, you know. Fairy tales? You know something, boy? This shinola is wonderful stuff.
Remember, Miss Monroe, it's very important
Attention, please, on your toes, everyone. Orson Von Hope is coming down the hall.
At ease, smoke if you like.
Your table is ready, sir.
Oh, fabulous, my good man. Would you take this splendid beast out and feed him for me, please?
Huh? Of course. Perhaps some steak or chops for the dog?
No, he's had enough of that. Just take him out in the kitchen. Let him gnaw on the chef's leg for a while. Go on, be a good girl, Zsa Zsa. Go, baby. I'll throw you an old director later. Thank you very much. That's enough, girl. Let's not overdo it. Thank you.
How now? What can I do for you, gentlemen?
All I want is a cup of coffee.
Cup of coffee. Yes, sir. And what can I do for you, Mr. Von Hope, sir?
I'll have a tomato surprise with some French dressing, if they have it.
If they don't, I'll swim over and get you some.
I've been waiting for this chance to talk to you. The front office isn't happy about your last picture.
How dare those peasants criticize Von Hope? Me, the genius who dared put Rubarosa in that new picture, How to Marry a Millionaire. How can they do that?
Forget about that. Face the facts. The picture was bad. It's the first time an audience ever asked for their money back on the way in.
Now, wait a minute. Godfrey, how can you talk that way to me? Don't forget. If it wasn't for me, you'd still be recapping sneakers for Howard Hughes. Remember that.
I tell you, you need something big to pull you out of the slump. You got to redeem yourself. You need a new story.
Yes, but I'm not going to redeem myself with a new story. I need a new personality. I need a new face, an unknown.
Well, how about me? I'm an unknown. Nobody knows me. I don't even know myself.
Miss, would you please serve the salad? Mr. Von Hope hasn't got all day.
Oh, sure,
Godfrey, I think you have a good idea there. I think, four. I think you have a fine idea.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. It's very difficult to find that kind of personality.
Sorry, we were playing through. Now, let me ask you something. No, I'll tell you what I think.
It's very difficult, Chief, to find a new face in this
town.
I
want to write the right face, though. I must get the right face for my next production. And when I find her, I guarantee you, Godfrey, that I will make a fantasy if I could only find...
Oh, but finding the right face, Chief, that's
all. That's all I need. Possible. Find the right face. That's
oh,
all
so
I need.
Many
I can see it all now.
I don't know I what you mean by a right face.
I'll find it, I tell you. It may be hard, but I'll find it. If I could only find the right face, I could
get the right face.
That's all I have to do. Pardon me, I gotta take a Tums. I'll be right back.
Good evening. This is Luella Hopper with your Hollywood news. And now, here is my first scoop. Hollywood is buzzing with the story of Empire Pictures' top director, Orson Von Hope, and his new Cinderella discovery. The big question is, can a great genius like Orson turn an inexperienced waitress into a great actress? And will he be able to make the top brass at Empire see it his way? Well, we'll soon have the answer, because Marion Monroe gets her screen test today. And now, good night from Hollywood.
All right, my doll. Now look, I want you to listen to the director. We've been rehearsing this for days, and we must try it once more. Go.
Rodney, my darling, please do not go out into the jungle, because there are all sorts of dangers. No!
Stop! Stop! Oh, it's miserable. No, I must have it with more feeling, more meaning. I want it with depth.
Yes.
Not that. No. Not that deep. Up a little, please.
Rodney, my dog.
Nope.
Oh, I can't do it. I tell
yes,
you, I can't.
Can.
I'm a flop. I'm a failure. I'm a slob.
Please, take it easy. It's not as bad as all that. Don't
oh,
worry
I
about
can't
a thing.
Help it.
No, please. It's all right. Don't worry about it.
Oh, it's terrible. I'm a flop.
I've been through this so many times, I have a roller handkerchief. Come on, baby, we're going to take this once again. Once again, my dear, and I'll do the scene with you. Now, here's the idea. You see, our plane has been forced down in the jungle. You understand? Now, we're isolated.
Chief,
all at once.
Chief.
Yes.
Big Brass is on its way over to watch you shoot the screen test. I hope you're ready.
Marion, put on your costume. We'll do the best we can. Don't worry.
Oh, I hope this comes off, Chief. You know what happens when you have a flop in Hollywood.
I know. It means goodbye. Today, you're at Ciro's drinking wine. Tomorrow, you're up at Fresno crushing the grapes.
Well, good luck, Purple Foot.
Oh, Godfrey, if I could only pick this up.
Martin,
yes?
Would you help me out with my shoes,
yes,
please?
Yes, I will, my dear. Here you are. I told you I'd make a big woman out of you. There you are.
They're here. They're
Yes. Oh, come in, gentlemen. Dory, Daryl. Nice to see you.
Austin, how are you? Now, you know we're very busy men, so come on. What have you got here for
well,
us?
Well, gentlemen, I just want you to sit down. I'll show you some of the greatest acting talent to hit Hollywood in years. Just
all
sit right,
right
down
all right,
there.
Crew. Austin's ready.
Yes, this is it. Now, I must have complete quiet on the set. Quiet on the set. Quiet on the set. Who's that doing all the yelling around here?
You are, Chief.
That's what I hate about this studio. You have to do everything yourself. All right, let's go. Camera, lights, action. Artist.
Rodney, my darling, please do not go out into the jungle, because there are all sorts of dangers lurking there.
And I can't.
Yes, you
can.
I can't do it.
Continue, honey. Stay
I can't.
There.
I can't. I can't. No, I'm a flop. I'm a failure. I'm a flop.
Congratulations, Orson. You've done it again. A star is born. Oh, what an actress. What emotion. Such realism. Mark my words. She's another Francis the Mule. That's right. We'll sign the contracts in the morning.
Yo, fuck. Come down. How about that?
Oh, Orson. I made it.
How about that? I molded you. I taught you how to walk and talk. I breathed some of my genius into you and transformed you into a star.
Yes. And now it's goodbye.
Goodbye?
But of course, now that I'm a star, I can't afford a broken down director like you.
You mean there's others?
Why, of course. Oh, Porfirio!
Jack Benny, you mean to tell me you take a bit part like this?
Bob, since my daughter's wedding, I have to pick up every dollar I can make.
Remember how much work it used to be to make rice? How you had to wash it and rinse it and drain it and steam it?
Yeah. You don't have that work with minute rice. Just add it to boiling water.
Are you serious? Just add to boiling water? No cooking?
Mm-hmm. My wife says it's the fastest rice she's ever fixed. It doesn't need washing. It's so good, too. It's never mushy or sticky. It's always perfect. She wouldn't use anything but minute rice. Here, why don't you try it?
I will. And if minute rice is half as good as you say it is, I'm certainly going to use it. Thank you.
Folks, when you go to your grocer's tomorrow, head straight for Bob Hope. There you'll find minute rice, as well as some swell recipe leaflets showing how to make delicious treats like minute rice tuna treats. Get minute rice. It's the most exciting rice you ever tried. There's no other rice like it. Minute Rice. It's prepared instantly. Makes perfect rice without cooking. Get it for sure tomorrow. Minute Rice.
My privilege to announce a contest in connection with our new Paramount picture, Casanova's Big Night, with Joan Fontaine and Basil Rathbone, and we're trying to find the leading college campus, Casanova, and we're asking all sororities to make their choice. Each university is eligible to nominate one candidate, so send us a picture of your campus, Casanova, and a 100-word statement explaining his qualifications. The final winner will be picked by five of Hollywood's most glamorous stars and will be my guest in the movie capital for a one-week whirl. We'll start at Stan's Drive-In, and we'll just whip from there. Now, I want to tell you. It'll be a great time, I guarantee. All entries must be postmarked by March 27, 1954. Address entries to Bob Hope, Casanova's Big Night, 5451 Marathon Street, Hollywood 28, California. Thank you very, very much. Say, Janis Paige, come out here, honey. I just want to talk to you. Wonderful job, and you're going back to rehearse.
Oh, it was such fun.
You're going to rehearse in the new
show. I take the plane out tonight, and I'm in rehearsal tomorrow in New York City at 11 o'clock.
The Pajama Game by George Abbott, huh?
Right.
And Freddie Brisson's producing and all
right.
That.
Right.
Isn't that wonderful? We wish
it's very exciting.
Nothing but luck, and come back
Thank
and
you.
Visit us, will you?
You bet I will. And I would just like to say that I think you're a doll, and you're my favorite star.
Thank you, baby.
And I would just like to say thanks for everything.
Well, we're wonderful
know?
Having you, doll.
And will you sing a little song with me?
You know I will. I'll go.
All right, Les. You are my lucky star. I goofed.
I saw you from afar.
You opened heaven's portals.
Here on earth for this poor mortal.
You are my lucky star.
Honey, wait in the jet. Ladies and gentlemen, we have a David.
Well, I just dropped by to say goodbye, and I love being on your show. I wouldn't have missed it for anything. I enjoyed every minute of it, and it was great working with you. Don't forget to send my check.
Yeah. Oh. This is the smoothest claw machine I ever met.
This is good night.
Now, hold it, Lipton. Wait a minute. Listen, won't you sing a little song for us?
Oh, Bob, I don't sing.
No, but everybody sings.
I know, isn't it nauseating? I think all this singing's so overrated. Little men in derbies write songs telling you to wake up and sing. I'd rather wake up and brush my teeth. Then they ask you to go out singing in the rain. Why open your mouth with all this water coming down? I don't want to get floating kidneys.
It played. Aren't you going a little overboard on this thing?
Bob, did you ever hear of a nauseating little number called Let's All Sing Like the Birdies Sing? That's really ridiculous. What would Bing sound like if he sang with a worm in his mouth?
Well, doesn't he? I know he wears the nest. Why, what else? No, but listen. Let me tell you. You should sing something, don't you think?
Bob, not only do I have no voice, I don't even know how to make the necessary gestures with my
eyes. Oh, wait a minute. I'll help you with that. Do you want me to give you a lesson on that? I'll tell you. You sing That's Amore, just a chorus of it, and I'll show you how to work. Just put your arms behind here. Go, Les. Go.
When the moon hits your eye like a big pizza pie, that's amore. When the world seems to shine like you've had too much wine, that's amore. Bells will ring, ting-a-ling-a-ling, ting-a-ling-a-ling, and you'll sing the better. Tippy-tay, tippy-tippy-tay, like a guitar and when the stars make us cool, just like a pastel,
Niveny sound just like Dean Martin, didn't he?
Yeah.
Cass, honey, you did a wonderful job, baby.
Thank you.
Come back
Thank
again.
You. I will.
And
I
how about singing a little song before you go?
Well, I really didn't come prepared, Bob,
oh,
but
come, Cass.
If the boys would like to play one, I'll... There'll be a change in the weather and a change in the sea. From now on, there'll be a change in me.
Jacket on her. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to tell you, next week, Milton Berle and his wonderful Buick show, and 4 weeks from tonight, we'll be back with our guest stars, Jack Benny and Rosemary Clooney. Yes, sir, and you know the 60 minutes are near gone, so just let me... Oh, before, ladies and gentlemen, you know the slogan of the American Red Cross is join and serve. While you may not be on the scene in person to aid disaster victims, troubled servicemen, or that child who must have blood to live, you can and do help when you join the American Red Cross. So answer the call and join and serve the Red Cross. You know, the 60 minutes are near gone, so just let me say a nice word about some nice products. Just want to talk about minute rice, because it really does give you perfect rice without cooking. So be sure to pick up a couple of packages at your grocer's tomorrow, and don't forget Jell-O instant pudding for busy day desserts. Try them both soon. I'll see you. Good night.
The Bob Hope Show has been brought to you by amazing new minute rice for perfect rice without cooking and wonderful new Jell-O instant pudding, America's busy day dessert. 4 weeks from tonight, be sure to watch The Bob Hope Show with Bob's special guests, Jack Benny and Rosemary Clooney. Featured tonight were Verna Felton, High Averback, Elvia Allman, Mr. Priva, and Lois Corey. Until 4 weeks from tonight, this is High Averback saying good night for Bob Hope, minute rice, and Jell-O instant pudding.
Boy, what an audience. We got to get a net.
Look at all these tomato stains on my mother's dress. Imagine them throwing tomatoes.
The least they could have done was take them out of the cans.
Bob, what went wrong with the act?
Everything, honey, everything. Look,
When I said my middle name is Lifesaver, you were supposed to say, is that because you have a hole in your head? Not, I think Lifesaver's a pretty name. Where'd you get that line?
Well, I can't help it. I did everything else right. When you said, where do bugs go in the wintertime? I said, search me. Why didn't that get a laugh?
Oh, I don't know. It's on account of that act down ahead of us, that crummy act doing all our jokes. That blonde, that dumb blonde, and that guy with the cigar. What was the name of that act?
Burns and Allen.
Why don't people like that give up and buy a chicken ranch? Where are they going anyway? Don't worry, honey. When we get to Sandusky, we'll fix up this vehicle, and I tell you...
Oh, there you are.
Mother, Lunt and Fontaine.
Oh, I finally caught up with you.
Mrs. Rosequist, what are you doing here?
I followed you down here on the bus. And I was in the audience this evening.
Oh, how'd you like the act, Ma? You know, it's a little rough, but you got to admit it's got something.
Yeah. And it'll take them a month to get it out of the curtains. Mildred, get your suitcase. You're going home with me.
Now, just a minute.
I've got two words for you. Drop dead.
Told me that back in Cleveland.
Yeah, I know, but you haven't done it yet. I didn't raise my girl to go on the stage with you. You over-smoked ham.
Now, just a minute. Hold it. I got plenty of talent. All I need is a little funny material.
You'll never improve on what Mother Nature gave you.
Thank you, 100 proof.
100 proof?
Yeah, old crow. I can't help it. Now, wait a minute, Mrs. Rosequist. Mrs. Rosequist, I just want to say a couple of words. I hope you realize that you're the dark cloud that's hiding two rising young stars, two people that are destined to climb the ladder of success to the pinnacle of fame and fortune. Don't you think?
Ah, shut up!
Nerve of that woman. Should have known she'd be around. Bats always come out after dark. Telling me I got no talent. The last show I did, my dressing room was filled with flowers. Cost me $50, but it was worth it.
Miss Monroe! Miss Monroe, come here at once! Oh. I've just had word that the most important director on the Empire lot is on his way over here for lunch. I refer, of course, to Orson Van Hope.
Oh, gee. And I'm trying to get in pictures. You know, he's liable to walk in here, take one look at me, and make me a star. Oh, boy, I better look my best, huh? Fairy tales can come true.
Ah, there. How's that? Is my makeup smeared?
On that face, how does one tell?
Yeah, I know. When I was born, the doctor slapped the wrong end. Oh, well, I better freshen up anyway. You can never tell, you know. Fairy tales? You know something, boy? This shinola is wonderful stuff.
Remember, Miss Monroe, it's very important that when...
Attention, please, on your toes, everyone. Orson Von Hope is coming down the hall.
At ease, smoke if you like.
Your table is ready, sir.
Oh, fabulous, my good man. Would you take this splendid beast out and feed him for me, please?
Huh? Of course. Perhaps some steak or chops for the dog?
No, he's had enough of that. Just take him out in the kitchen. Let him gnaw on the chef's leg for a while. Go on, be a good girl, Zsa Zsa. Go, baby. I'll throw you an old director later. Thank you very much. That's enough, girl. Let's not overdo it. Thank you.
How now? What can I do for you, gentlemen?
All I want is a cup of coffee.
Cup of coffee. Yes, sir. And what can I do for you, Mr. Von Hope, sir?
I'll have a tomato surprise with some French dressing, if they have it.
If they don't, I'll swim over and get you some.
I've been waiting for this chance to talk to you. The front office isn't happy about your last picture.
How dare those peasants criticize Von Hope? Me, the genius who dared put Rubirosa in that new picture, How to Marry a Millionaire. How can they do that?
Forget about that. Face the facts. The picture was bad. It's the first time an audience ever asked for their money back on the way in.
Now, wait a minute. Godfrey.
Godfrey, all those pretty girls.
Godfrey, listen to this. It's my line. Listen. I tell you, Godfrey, I don't want a pretty girl. I want a girl with strength, a girl with character. Soft spot.
Chief, the search for the kind of girl you want to find could be endless. It could take years.
No, don't you worry about Godfrey. I have a feeling that that face is somewhere right around here. Yes, I saw it here. That waitress. You.
Me?
I'm going to make a star out of you.
Me?
Yes. I'm going to take your face. I'm going to take that face. Pardon me, I got to take a Tums. I'll be right back.
Good evening. This is Luella Hopper with your Hollywood news. And now, here is my first scoop. Hollywood is buzzing with the story of Empire Pictures' top director, Orson Von Hope, and his new Cinderella discovery. The big question is, can a great genius like Orson turn an inexperienced waitress into a great actress? And will he be able to make the top brass at Empire see it his way? Well, we'll soon have the answer, because Marion Monroe gets her screen test today. And now, good night from Hollywood.
All right, my doll. Now, look, I want you to listen to the director. We've been rehearsing this for days, and we must try it once more. Go.
Rodney, my darling, please do not go out into the jungle, because there are all sorts of dangers. No!
Stop! Stop! Oh, it's miserable. No, I must have it with more feeling, more meaning. I want it with depth.
Yes.
Not that. No. Not that deep. Up a little, please. Honey, you must be lonesome when I go away like that. You ought to find yourself a hobby. She found it. What are these?
The doctor must have left those.
Oh, really?
Uh-huh.
And how about this?
Well, he was a pharmacist's mate. That's the only medical man I could find in the middle of the night.
Yeah, and what about this here?
Well, you see, he drives a cab when his ship is in dry dock. Oh, I tell you, I had a terrible fever. I was just absolutely burning up.
Yeah, well, how about this here?
Well?
I know, he put out the fire.
Well, gentlemen, I think I have a solution to your problem. Your girlfriends are obviously not suitable. One is too demonstrative, and the other is not demonstrative enough. Therefore, I suggest that you exchange girlfriends.
Well, that's a great idea.
Good.
Here's a photograph of my girlfriend. Well, just a minute. This is my girl.
But this is my girl.
You think you guys got trouble? That's my wife.
We'll be right back. sweller than the kiss I give my feller in the morning, where the morning glories twine around my door, whispering pretty stories I want to hear once more. Strolling with my Louie where the dew is super dewy in the morning. Butterflies all flutter up and kiss each little buttercup at dawning. If I had Aladdin's lamp for only a day, you know what? I'd make a wish, and here's what I'd say, quote, nothing could be finer than to be Carolina in the morning.
Saturday was a pretty typical example. I went round to the apartment of a young lady I've known for some time.
Darling, you're here at last. I've been going out of my mind listening for your footsteps, lady, to hear your voice. Oh, you don't know what you do to me. Take me in your arms and kiss me, kiss me, kiss me!
Oh, stop nagging.
How can you treat me like this? You know I'm starved for your affection. My lips are burning with desire. You haven't kissed me since Friday.
That'll have to hold you over the weekend.
I know I'm not much to look at, nothing to see, but why can't I have a man crazy for me? Well, say something.
Will it be a hit or a miss? Yeah, you seem a little overwrought. I think I'll take a walk around the block until your blood settles down to a slow boil.
Oh! If you go out that door, if you go out that door, I'll jump!
You're bluffing. Fool me.
All right, sir, what about your problem?
Oh, well, the girl I go with is madly in love with me. There's no other man in the world for her.
Well, what's your problem?
Well, I'm insanely jealous. For no reason at all, I'm suspicious of her. Like last night, I went to visit her. All right, baby, let your hair down. Lover Lips is here to make it curl.
It's you.
Oh, well, honey, don't get too excited. There's enough for me to go around. Man, 3 weeks in San Francisco. 3 long weeks.
When are you going?
Going? I just got back. Did you miss me, honey? What'd you do while I was away?
Oh, I just sat here night after night knitting.
Must have used some awfully tricky needles. Honey, you must be lonesome when I go away like that. You ought to find yourself a hobby. She found it. What are these?
The doctor must have left those.
Oh, really?
Uh-huh.
And how about this?
Well, he was a pharmacist's mate. That's the only medical man I could find in the middle of the night.
Yeah, and what about this here?
Well, you see, he drives a cab when his ship is in dry dock. Oh, I tell you, I had a terrible fever. I was just absolutely burning up.
Yeah, well, how about this here?
Well?
I know, he put out the fire.
Well, gentlemen, I think I have a solution to your problem.
Grim. In fact, we sang our last song from a crouching position so we could get to the exit in a hurry.
Boy, what an audience. We gotta get a net.
Look at all these tomato stains on my mother's dress. Imagine them throwing tomatoes.
The least they could have done was take them out of the cans.
Now, what went wrong with the act?
Everything, honey, everything. Look, when I said my middle name is Lifesaver, you were supposed to say, is that because you have a hole in your head? Not, I think Lifesaver's a pretty name. Where'd you get that line?
Well, I can't help but
but I did everything else right. When you said, where do bugs go in the wintertime, I said, search me. Why didn't that get a laugh?
Oh, I don't know. It's on account of that act down ahead of us, that crummy act doing all our jokes. That blonde, that dumb blonde, and that guy with the cigar. What was the name of that act?
Burns and Allen.
Why don't people like that give up and buy a chicken ranch? Where are they going anyway? Don't worry, honey. When we get to Sandusky, we'll fix up this vehicle, and I tell you...
There you are.
Mother!
Lunt and Fontaine. Oh, I finally caught up with you.
Mrs. Rosequist, what are you doing here?
I followed you down here on the bus. And I was in the audience this evening.
Oh, how'd you like the act, Ma? You know, it's a little rough, but you got to admit it's got something.
Yeah. And it'll take them a month to get it out of the curtains. Mildred, get your suitcase. You're going home with me.
Now, just a minute.
I've got two words for you. Drop dead.
You told me that back in Cleveland.
Yeah, I know, but you haven't done it yet. I didn't raise my girl to go on the stage with you, you over-smoked ham.
Now, just a minute. Hold it. I got plenty of talent. All I need is a little funny material.
You'll never improve on what Mother Nature gave you.
Thank you, 100 proof.
100 proof?
Yeah, old crow. I can't help it.
Oh, that did it. Come, Mildred.
Now, wait a minute. Mrs. Rosequist... Mrs. Rosequist, I just want to say a couple of words. I hope you realize that you're the dark cloud that's hiding two rising young stars, two people that are destined to climb the ladder of success to the pinnacle of fame and fortune. Don't you think?
Ah, shut up!
Nerve of that woman. Should have known she'd be around. Bats always come out after dark. Telling me I got no... You'll see the winners on TV this year. It'll be a little complicated because the losers are demanding equal time. I understand that I'm very close to 2 Oscars this year. I'm sitting between Levant and Hammerstein. And I think it's funny that Frank Sinatra should get a nomination as Best Supporting Actor all these years. He's the one that's needed the support. And I think it's just, but we hope you enjoy our show tonight. We really do. We have a nice cast here. We have Janis Paige and her all-girl figure. She's back with us. This is sort of a repeat performance, a second appearance with me. She's very talented and very brave. And Janis, of course, will soon be opening in a new musical show on Broadway. She has a very important part in the pajama game. I don't know if it's the top or the bottoms, but it's a very important And, of course, we're very lucky to get David Niven tonight on the show. You all saw David in the Academy Award nomination for the Best Picture of the Year, The Moon is Blue, originally titled Space Cadet and His Leaky Fountain Pen. And also, we have Cass Daley with us, a triumphant return engagement. After her last appearance with us, some people wrote in and said, isn't she a little crazy? I'm here to tell you that Cass is perfectly all right. She has all her marbles. Just that she carries them around in her pocket. And Les Brown and his wonderful band of renown, of course, he's with us. He's still there. The boys are a little tired this evening. The bass fiddle needed restringing, and Les has had them out running down cats all day, so they're a little beat. Aren't they, huh? So is that joke. But anyway, I want to tell you this. Coming up now is a fine, fine product called Minute Rice, and I want you to try it. At our house, we think it's the lightest, fluffiest rice we ever ate. And Dolores says that with Minute Rice, you really do get perfect rice without cooking. You're going to see how true that is right now.
this time, ladies and gentlemen, the makers of No Fat, the diatonic salami that leaves your breath kissing sweet, are proud to present Postcards to Priscilla. And here is the star of our show, Priscilla Plump.
I want to thank all you lovely people for taking the time to write me. You have no idea how much your sad, miserable postcards are doing to me. They're making me rich. Please keep on writing me about your miserable lives. Tonight's miserable postcard comes from a miserable little man who signs himself Miserable. Dear Priscilla, have you ever thought about what goes through a man's mind on his first visit to a psychiatrist's office? As he sits wondering what sort of monster he is about to meet, he can't help feeling that he has made a mistake coming here at all. There's nothing wrong with him. He's no different than anyone else. Or is he? And then the big problem. Does he dare tell the psychiatrist what is really on his mind?
Haven't been waiting long, but the doctor was called out on an emergency. What is your name, please?
Priscilla Plump. I mean, David Nosegay. Oh, nurse, will the doctor be here soon? This is my first visit to a psychiatrist's office, and I'm rather edgy.
Oh, he'll be here any minute now. Would you care to wait in his office?
Thank you.
Sorry about the delay, but the doctor was having to mix up in appointments. May I take your things?
Oh, thank you.
Make yourself comfortable.
Thank
you. All right, let's have a little brain service here. Where's the head shrinker?
As we wait behind the rope to see that no colliders once upon the drum. Here he comes. It's on.
That's our little St. Patrick's number, and I want to welcome you to our Jello show. You know, tomorrow is St. Patrick's Day. Faith and begotta, top of the morning. Saints preserve us, and a happy Pat O'Brien to you all. Yes, sir, in honor of St. Patrick's Day, my sponsor's coming out with a special package of lime Jello. It's shaped like Morton Downey. I hope you like it. But you can say what you want about the Irish if you have enough insurance. And I want to tell you right now, there are nothing but Irish tunes on the radio, and it's all very democratic. I heard one announcer say today, and now Pat O'Reilly and his four shamrocks play Irish Eyes. But first, a word from our sponsor, Manischewitz Wine. You know, the last time Marilyn Monroe was in Ireland, she kissed the Blarney Stone. It's the first time the Blarney Stone ever kissed back. It was quite... And, of course, this St. Patrick's Day down in Washington, they tell me Secretary of the Army Stevens is singing, Ireland must be heaven because McCarthy isn't there. President Eisenhower takes the bass part, but you know, these days, you can't... Really, you can't open a newspaper without reading about McCarthy. Yesterday was a headline that said, McCarthy ties shoelaces. Army claims he tied left one first. That's what it said in the paper. I'm glad I didn't. But I want to tell you one thing. No, honestly, I don't think Secretary Stevens harbors any grudge against Senator McCarthy. It's just a coincidence that the draft law has been changed to include all married senators of 45 who come from Wisconsin. Now, I think it's just a coincidence. I really do. And too bad, it's too bad that we don't have color TV, ladies and gentlemen, so you folks out there could see this opening St. Patrick's number with all that color. I haven't seen that much green since Jack Benny came out of his vault to pay for the wedding. I
don't know how much the wedding costs, but it's the first time the bride's father ever cried louder than the mother. I was there, I want to tell you. I was the tallest flower girl there, and I loved it. And I've never seen such a spectacle. What a wedding that was. That's what the coronation would have been like if England had Benny's money.
That's right. We'll sign the contracts in the morning.
Oh, how about that?
Oh, Orson, I made it.
How about that? I molded you. I taught you how to walk and talk. I breathed some of my genius into you and transformed you into a star.
Yes. And now it's goodbye.
Goodbye?
But of course. Now that I'm a star, I can't afford a broken-down director like you.
You mean there's others?
Why, of course. Oh, Porfirio!
Jack Benny, you mean to tell me you'd take a bit part like this?
Bob, since my daughter's wedding, I have to pick up every dollar I can make.
I know who he is. Bob Hope. I can tell by his nose.
That's right.
Is that your picture of Bob Hope?
No. That belongs to the Minute Rights people. It's in all the stores.
Why? Why is Bob Hope picture in all the stores?
Well, Bob wants to tell everybody what a sensational rice Minute Rice is. It's different from any other rice in the whole world. Bob wants everybody to try this Minute Rice tuna dish that you see in the picture.
I like tuna fish. Mommy, can we have this for supper tonight?
Well, I don't know, dear. What is it?
This is the Minute Rice tuna treat Bob Hope is recommending. A wonderful idea for lunch. It's a pinch to pick, as long as you use Minute Rice.
Why, Minute Rice? Will any rice do?
Mm-hmm, no, ma'am. Minute Rice means perfect rice without cooking. Remember how much work it used to be to make rice? How you had to wash it and rinse it and drain it and steam it?
Yeah.
You don't have that work with Minute Rice. Just add it to boiling water.
Are you serious? Just add to boiling water? No cooking?
Mm-hmm. My wife says it's the fastest rice she's ever picked. It doesn't need watching. It's so good, too. It's never mushy or sticky. It's always perfect. She wouldn't use anything but Minute Rice. Here, why don't you try it?
I will. And if Minute Rice is half as good as you say it is, I'm certainly going to use it. Thank you.
Folks, when you go to your grocer's tomorrow, head straight for Bob Hope. There you'll find Minute Rice, as well as some swell recipe leaflets showing how to make delicious treats like Minute Rice tuna treats. Get Minute Rice. It's the most exciting rice you ever tried. There's no other rice like it.
Oh, just a minute. This is my girl.
But this is my girl.
You think you guys got trouble? That's my wife.
Strolling with my Louie, where the dew is super dewy in the morning. Butterflies all flutter up and kiss each little buttercup at dawning. If I had Aladdin's lamp for only a day, you know what? I'd make a wish and here's what I'd say, quote, nothing could be finer than to be Carolina in the morning.
darling. Please do not go out into the jungle. Because there are all sorts of dangers. No!
Stop! Stop! Oh, it's miserable. No, I must have it with more feeling, more meaning. I want it with depth.
Yes.
Not
that, no. Not that deep. Up a little, please.
Randy, my dog. Oh, I can't do it. I tell
yes,
you, I
can't. Can.
I'm a flop. I'm a failure. I'm a slob.
My bad leg. Please, no, please, take it easy. It's not as bad as all that. Don't
oh,
worry about it.
I can't help it.
No, please, it's all right. Don't worry about it.
Oh, it's terrible. I'm a slob.
I've been through this so many times, I have a roller handkerchief. Oh, baby, we're going to take this once again. Once again, my dear, and I'll do the scene with you. Now, here's the idea. You see, our plane has been forced down in the jungle. You understand? Now, we're isolated.
Chief,
all at once.
Chief.
Yes.
Big Brass is on its way over to watch you shoot the screen test. I hope you're ready.
Marion, put on your costume. We'll do the best we can. Don't worry.
Oh, I hope this comes off, Chief. You know what happens when you have a flop in Hollywood.
I know. It means goodbye. Today, you're at Ciro's drinking wine. Tomorrow, you're up at Fresno crushing the grapes. I tell you.
Well, good luck, Purplefoot.
Yeah. Oh, Godfrey, if I could only think of something.
Martin,
yes?
Would you help me out with my shoes,
yes,
please?
Yes, I will, my dear. Here you are. I'd make a big woman out of you. There you are.
They're here.
Oh, yes. Oh, come in, gentlemen. Dory, Daryl. Nice to see you.
Austin, how are you? Now, you know we're very busy men, so come on. What have you got here
well,
for us?
Well, gentlemen, I just want you to sit down. I'll show you some of the greatest acting talent to hit Hollywood in years. Just
all
sit right,
right
down
right,
there.
All right, crew. Austin's ready.
Yes, this is it. Now, I must have complete quiet on the set. Quiet on the set. Quiet on the set. Who's that doing all the yelling around here?
You are, Chief.
That's what I hate about this studio. You have to do everything yourself. All right, let's go. Camera, lights. Action! Artist!
Rodney, my darling, please do not go out into the jungle, because there are all sorts of dangers.
The first visit to a psychiatrist's office, and I'm rather edgy.
Oh, he'll be here any minute now. Would you care to wait in his office?
Thank you.
But the doctor was having mix-up in appointments. May I take your things?
Oh, thank you.
Make yourself comfortable.
Thank you.
All right, let's have a little brain service here. Where's the head shrinker? Fine way to run a psychiatrist's office. Doesn't even have a nurse. I bet she's in there necking with him. If I had a nurse, that's what I'd be doing.
Oh, you crazy mixed-up gourd. Oh, my skull.
Oh, there you are. What time you got here?
Oh, am I late?
Well, it doesn't matter. Let's get started.
You read any good books lately?
It's rather uncomfortable, isn't it?
Yeah. Maybe it isn't for skinnier people. Where do we start?
Well, first of all, I think that $50 an hour is outrageous.
So do I.
I think 20 is more than enough.
Would you think 10 would be more than enough?
Yes, I would.
Let's settle for 5.
Oh, good show. I've always thought the psychiatry was too expensive.
You know what this country needs is a cut-rate psychiatrist who goes from door to door with a hammock on a pushcart.
Look, I don't want to be old-fashioned, but aren't you supposed to be up there in the driver's seat?
No, you are.
Oh. Are you sure? In England, it's the other way around.
Yeah, but you drive on the wrong side of the street there, too.
A bit peculiar, but I'll take a crack at it.
Well, Wizard, let's get started, huh?
Well, first I'll give you the details of my early childhood.
I can't think of a more nauseating proposition. Look, you have this backwards. I talk, you listen.
You quite sure?
Quite.
Well, you give me the details of your early childhood.
How early?
Well, you can start with your birth. There's not much point in going back any further than that.
My childhood. Oh, how different life would have been if only I'd been born a woman. Or a man. Or even a boy. But I was just a baby. Living in an incubator. Dad couldn't afford a crib, so he tossed me in with the chickens. For a long while, I thought I was one of the hens. Took the rooster a whole year to talk me out of laying an egg at the crack of dawn.